Hey everybody, welcome back. And in this video, we're going to be doing a little bit of blueprint scripting to get the functionality that we want for our sliding glass door. Now, blueprint scripting is Unreal Engine 4's visual scripting system, as the name suggests. And if you are not a programmer or don't have a C++ background or know any form of code, blueprints is a very handy way to kind of visually script any kind of gameplay sequences or gameplay events in a very easy to use manner. So there are several videos that cover blueprints. We're not gonna cover the history of blueprints in this video. We're just gonna do enough to get you going here. So let's go ahead and just continue with our office example here. And the first thing that we're gonna need to do actually though is over in the modes panel, we're gonna grab a box trigger. So let's go ahead and grab a box trigger and drag that into our level here. And what this is going to allow us to do is that anytime the player enters this box trigger through blueprints, we can call some script to have our door either open or close. So when they enter it, we can open our door. When they exit it, it will close our door. So with that, let's actually scale up our box so it's a little bit bigger. We're going to hit R to enter scale mode, and we're going to uniformly scale it by clicking the box in the middle and just scaling it up a little bit. Something like that. That's good enough. And we're going to scale it up along the Z as well, just like that. Should be good enough for our purposes. So I hit W to go back to that and escape actually to deselect it. There's one other thing that we need to do to our door to actually make it movable if we select it. The first thing is that we are currently set to static. So this object cannot be moved in game. So we're going to go ahead and change that and click on its mobility setting and make it movable, so that when we call it through script, it will actually move. So make sure we do that. And I think we're ready to start actually scripting now. So there's a couple different ways we can use blueprints. For the purposes of this video, we're just gonna do this inside the level blueprint, which is the most common way, I guess. Well, maybe not the most common, maybe the easiest way for our example here. So we're gonna do that. And across the top here, we have the option for blueprints. So first thing we're going to do is click our trigger box here, make sure that it is selected. And then we're going to go to the blueprints button up here. We're going to click it and we're going to open the level blueprint. Now give it a second for that to open up. And once it does, you are presented with a graph. And this is the event graph. This is where all of our script will be created. Now yours might look a little bit different than mine, especially on this event begin play node here. Because I think I was doing something in between videos, but we're not going to worry about it. I can explain what these do really quickly. The event begin play, essentially, whatever is connected to this wire here, whenever our game starts, this node will be called and any script that follows it will be executed. You probably have a tooltip above yours. I currently don't because I was playing with it. So bad me, I know. And we also have the event tick, which is called every frame, essentially. So anything that's connected to this wire will be called every frame while our game is running. We're not going to worry about either of these right now. We may come back to them in a moment. For our purposes, we're going to scroll down below those and we're going to right click. And if you recall, our trigger box was selected in our level. If it wasn't, just make sure that you select it and then open the level blueprint from the blueprints tab. Again, we're going to right click and we have add event for trigger box 7, which is our trigger box. It's got a aptly named box 7. Yours may be different again because I was playing between videos, but it's the same thing. We're going to click the expand option here and we're going to expand collision. Now we have a couple options in here. We have add on actor begin overlap, add on actor end overlap, and add on actor hit. We're actually only going to worry about these two. So let's select on actor begin overlap. Let's right click again and go to add event and collision and add on actor end overlap. So when the player overlaps our trigger box, execute this script. When the player leaves the trigger box, execute this script. So we have what it is we want. Now we need to figure out what we want to occur when the player does overlap and leave the trigger box. So we're gonna hop back over to the level, the actual level real quick. And if we select our door, so let's make sure our door is selected here. What we wanna do is have our door move in the X direction. So I'm gonna hit Control Z to get it back to its default location. Again, X is our red arrow here. You can see that by the little handy widget over here in the corner. We wanna have it move in the X direction. Control-Z one more time. And we can also look in the Details panel, and you can see all of our values are currently specified in the Transform section of our door. So right now, our X is currently sitting at negative 936. Now we want to move our door in this direction. We don't know how much, so let's just slide it over there and watch our X value here. So I'm going to grab it and slide it over. And you can see it's starting to go down. And as we continue to move it, we can move it all the way over to, say, let's move it to 836, actually, and see what that does. So our door is right about there at negative 836. We could slide it a little bit more, so let's actually do that. Let's actually go to 826. So our door would open to about this point, which looks good for us. So 826 is our value, and so that's, let's go back to 936, which was our default value. Let's get it back up there, 936. So 936 is our default value, 826, so 110 meters of movement is what we need for our X. So with that, let's hop back over to our level blueprint, and we're going to right click, and we're going to scroll all the way down to the bottom, and there's an option called Add Timeline. So let's go ahead and add this, and you can see the tooltip here. It says Timeline node allows values to be keyframed over time. So values being our the value of our X for our door, which can be keyframed over a specified time. So this will make more sense once we add it. Let's go ahead and add it. And let's add a name for it. Let's just call it door movement. Now the node itself is pretty self-explanatory if you look at it. There's a play from start, stop, reverse, etc. It looks pretty self-explanatory. So when the player overlaps our trigger box, we want to play our timeline. So I'm just going to left click and drag from this executable pin to this executable pin. Conversely, when we leave our trigger box, we want to reverse, so play in our current position backwards, so the door will close. So there is our timeline. That's all we need to do, really, for this point. I think we are good. Well, there's one more thing, actually. We need to actually add some functionality to our timeline, because right now it doesn't do anything. It just plays and reverses, but there's no values specified for our timeline here. So let's double click on our timeline actually to open it up. So if we double click on it, now we are presented with our curve editor essentially. And I guess I should have mentioned it that a timeline actually allows us to tap into our animation curves, which is what we're going to be adding here. And there's a couple options across the top. We're going to click this one here, which is a vector track. So go ahead and click that. And the vector track will allow us to represent position in X, Y, and Z space, which is what we want. So for our name here that it's prompting us, let's just add a name. We'll just call it movement. And you can see there's some icons up here that represent X, Y, and Z. Again, we only want to worry about the X. So we're going to click the lock icon next to Y, and we're going to click the lock icon next to Z to prevent us from adding keyframes for those. In fact, we're actually going to hide them as well by clicking those icons, those eye icons. Now, what we're going to do next is inside of the timeline here, we're actually going to hold shift and left click. Doesn't matter where you do it because we're going to enter in some values. You can see a keyframe has been added. And at the top, we have two boxes to enter values. We have time and we have the value. So for the time for this first keyframe, we're just going to enter 0. And for the value, we're also going to enter 0. So at time 0, our value is 0. We're going to hold shift and click left click inside the timeline again to create another keyframe. And for this one, we're going to specify a time that we want our door to open. And then we're going to specify the actual value that the door should open. So for our time, we're going to guess we want, say, 1.2 seconds for our door to open. That's how long it will take for our door to open. Hit enter. And for the value, you recall we needed 110 meters of movement. So let's go ahead and hit enter 110. And once we do so, our keyframe kind of disappears. It's there. We can get it again by clicking these two little boxes here, zoom to fit horizontal and zoom to fit vertical. And there is our line representing our two values over the specified 1.2 seconds. The last thing that we're going to do, well, there's two more things, actually. The first is we're going to check this box here that says use last keyframe, because we want to end once we hit this keyframe. The next thing that we're going to do, we're going to hold control, select this point here so that we have both of our keyframes selected. Then we're going to right click on the keyframe, and there's a couple options for key interpolation. This I'll explain in a moment. We're going to select auto. And what that will allow us to do is get a nice, smooth transition from our two points. So with that, I think we're done with our timeline. Let's go ahead and close this. We're about 10 minutes into this video. I think we're going to break here because we're going to do a little bit more script in the next video to finish off our sliding door movement. So with that, let's hit Control S to save really quickly. And let's pause here, and in the next video, we will finish off our script for our sliding door. We will see you in that video.